Ask of you. I am blessed with all that one can hope for, ask for. I have a mind to think, it is thy glory. I have eyes to see, ears to hear, all these are thy glory. I have in front of me a world so vast and so variegated, enough for me to express myself. Again it is thy glory. I can make, I can unmake, all these possibilities are again thy glory. I can even make this prayer to you. This capacity to appreciate you is again thy glory. I seek from thee nothing, for you have given me everything, inside me, outside me. Your presence is something that I can't miss, I don't want to miss. Let thy grace be upon me, not to gain anything new, but to make me see thy glory. In all my achievements, in all my capacity, let me see thy glory. O Lord, I have nothing to ask of thee. By constantly practicing such disciplines, one can reach the state of complete self-surrender and obtain deep-rooted, unmotivated devotion. The highest charity is to refrain from thinking ill of others and to refrain from harming them, and not the mere doling out of alms, ALM. Normally that is what you know, charity means we feel that. No? Truth is to seek God in everything. Dharma is the greatest wealth. Heroism lies in the conquest of one's own mind and lower nature, not in the killing of enemies. The greatest profit is the attainment of devotion and not of wealth. True beauty comes out of desirelessness and austerity, and not through decoration of the body. Hell is not a region, but the dominance of the quality of tamas. The greatest relation is the Guru, and he is none other than the Lord. The wealthy person is one who is rich in virtue, and the pauper is the greedy one, who is never satisfied whatever he might have. The house is the human body, and its master is the one who is free from attachment to it. The slave is the opposite. This, in brief, O Uddhava, is the description of the good and bad. Immediately Uddhava took him up on the statement, the scriptures teach us to distinguish between the two. So when you say that there is no distinction, I am confused. Pray enlighten me. The Blessed Lord replied, virtue and vice are determined by their relevance to the spiritual advancement of humanity, not by anything inherent in them. The system of determining actions and objects as good and good or bad has been laid down in the scriptures in order to check humanity from the pursuit of the animal instincts. Some of these rules are meant to help in spiritual progress. Some are relevant for practical reasons. What is described as good consists in adhering to the action and ways of living within one's spiritual and moral competency. The object of these rules is to make one more introspective. Papa used to say, that which one leads to God is right, that which one takes away from God is wrong. Any action, this is the only now. That which makes us closer to Him is right. That which makes us far away from Him is wrong. They can apply only to a certain situation dictated by time and place, the object. What is right in one context can be wrong in another. For instance, not to care for the home and family is wrong for the householder, but right for the sannyasi. An act that is a sin for a person of moral elevation need not be so for a fallen person or for one in a low state of evolution who is ignorant of rules. The person who is already fallen in the mud cannot have a further fall. The fall is for one who is high up. The lesson to be learned from this non-rigid nature of dharma and adharma is that people should come to realize the impermanent nature of the external world, slowly try to retire from the pursuit of material desires and fix their mind on the supreme reality. To the extent that one is able to do this, to that extent one will be free. If a person practicing sadhana happens to commit something of a sinful nature, that sin should be burned by the power of spiritual communion, not by the accepted code of penances. O Uddhava, this body is given for the purpose of attaining me. O Uddhava, this body is given for the purpose of attaining me. By practicing the three yogas prescribed by me, jnana, bhakti and karma, one will be able to attain the highest through this body alone. But one should bear in mind that this body is mortal. So a person of discrimination should strive constantly to realize the goal before being overtaken by death. Birds may perch on a tree, but when they see that the tree is being felled, they quickly change to another that is safe and unshakable. So also the tree of life is ever being chopped down by the master chopper. This is, you know, one after another. Before it is completely felled, those with wisdom will take their seat at my feet, which is firm and unshakable. The frail bark of your body may get wrecked by the mighty waves of anger, greed, passion. Attach yourself to me, therefore, and I shall take you across to the farther shore. In the form of your guru, I shall come and be your captain, mark your course, set your compass in the right direction. Then Uddhava questioned him about the phenomenon of death. The Lord answered, the mind, the five senses and the tendencies derived from karma constitute the linga sharira or karana sharira or the subtle body. This is what transmigrates from body to body. The mind of the dying man, swayed by his own actions and their impressions, thinks intensely on the outstanding experiences and attachments of his life. Consequently, he feels that he has entered a new body that has manifested itself by the very intensity of his thought. With the coming of the consciousness of the new body, there is complete oblivion of the old one and its history. On account of the intensity of attraction for the new body, the memory of the old one is completely effaced. Death is the complete forgetfulness of the old body. Birth is the complete identification with the next body. How this happens can be understood from the study of the dream state. In the dream state, the jiva becomes completely oblivious of its waking body and gets identified with its dream body. The flames rising from a fire and the water flowing down a stream are all being subjected to change, though we may not be aware of it. So also, time is subjecting the bodies of all creatures to the aging process. The Atman is the witness to these changes of birth and death of the body, but it is not subject to these processes. A man may observe a plant and note all its changes from sprout to sapling to tree, eventually its decay and degeneration, but he is totally different from all these states. So also the Atman is the knower of the body and its transformations and not a partner to them. The one who is ignorant, incapable of distinguishing the Atman from the body, identifies with it and is swept into the cycles of birth and death. If sattva is the predominating quality at the time of death, the jiva gets the body of a sage or a god. If rajas is the dominant element, it gets the body of an asura or a human being. And if tamas is predominating of a brute or a disembodied spirit, just as a person who witnesses a dance or a drama, dances and sings and laughs and weeps with the characters of the stage, by identifying intellectually with them, so also the jiva, though by nature actionless, is drawn by the intellect to behave as if it were the body. Just as the obsession with the dream experiences will remain with the sleeper as long as the dream lasts, so also the experience of the samsara will continue until one is awakened to the truth. Know well that it is only ignorance of the Atman that is the cause of delusion of the mind. So however you might be subjected to abuse, insult, ridicule, calumny, do not allow yourself to be shaken from your convictions. Remain calm within yourself. Look on all these beings as a product of your own past karmas. However you might be subjected to abuse, insult, ridicule, calumny, do not allow yourself to be shaken from your convictions. Remain calm within yourself. Look on all these as being only a product of your own past karma. As an example of this, the Lord told Uddhava the story of the mendicant who suffered all types of ridicule and insults with an equal mind, for he realized that it was but the result of the way he had treated people in the past when he had been young and rich. Thus goes the song of the mendicant. The mind alone is the sole cause of turning these mighty wheel of samsara. It is more powerful than all the senses. The one who conquers it is a true hero. Without conquering or making an effort to conquer this most invincible enemy, who works with unimaginable speed, the foolish person enters into vain quarrels with others, regarding them as friends, enemies or neutrals. The Atman alone is the sole reality, and the appearance of another is merely a figment of mind's imagination. People blame their stars for their misfortune. But how can the stars affect the Atman? They can only affect the body, and so only the one who identifies with the body can be affected by the stars and planets. The Atman is beyond all dualities. With whom then can one be angry? Does one knock out one's teeth because they happen to bite one's tongue? It is only the one who has not awakened to this truth who lives in fear of others. The Lord then continued, this samsara which produces happiness and misery and distinguishes among friend, foe and neutral is entirely the product of the mind. Therefore, O Uddhava, equipped with a mind that is totally dedicated to me, put your best efforts into controlling the mind. This is the sum and substance of all yoga. Samatvam yogam uchyate, you know. Equanimity is yoga. The Lord then spoke of the philosophy of creation and dissolution. The one pure consciousness, unmodified, and beyond the comprehension of thought and speech, becomes divided into two, as the seer and the seen, the subject and the object, as a consequence of the operation of my mysterious power called Maya. Of these two, one is Prakriti, the object, which is two states of manifest and unmanifest, and the other is the Purusha, the center of consciousness, the supreme subject. The jivas lying submerged in Prakriti comes into existence with their three aspects of sattva, rajas, tamas. Due to the urge of their karmic tendencies, all objects, big or small, are permeated by their cause, the tendencies, from whom they have sprung. This reality is the causal substance which forms the very stuff of the subjects. The effects have no substantiality apart from their cause. Brahman is the ultimate causal substance and therefore the ultimate reality. Time is the factor which manifests this universe of effects out of its causal condition. O Uddhava, the delusion of your mind will vanish if you reflect over these processes. The Lord next discussed the gunas and their effect on the mind. The Lord then warned Uddhava of the dangers of associating with those whose minds are given over to sensual pleasures. He narrated the story of King Kururuvas, who was led to his downfall by his dalliance with the heavenly nymph Urvashi, and who eventually attained liberation by associating with saints. The mind is easily swayed, and the company of holy men leads it naturally to a holy life. Just as food is the life of all living beings, so the holy person is the only relief for those who are sinking in the sea of samsara. The sun can give only your objective vision to see external subjects, but the saints can give you spiritual insight. Uddhava then begged him to briefly outline once more the three paths of jnana, bhakti and karma, as well as the method of ritualistic worship. The Blessed Lord replied, "God made gold made into diverse ornaments or lying in a lump by itself is still gold. Though the form changes, there is no change in its essential nature. So also know me to be the beginning, the middle, the end of all creation. If you can find me through jnana, then you will not have to seek far. From the highest Brahman to the lowest chandala, from the creator Brahma to the smallest of his creation, it is I and I alone. Discover me in everything and everybody. This is jnana. This is wisdom. Realize the unity in the midst of diversity. This, the ability to find out the essence of everything, is true intelligence. I alone shine in the heart of the raindrop as well as in the mighty ocean. That one is the jnani who knows this and acts accordingly. Know him to be the real pandit who perceives and honors all beings as my manifestation. Be they holy men or outcasts, persecutors or protectors, the sun or a spark of fire, a calm or a cruel person, overlooking the ridicule of friends and relatives, casting aside the sense of high and low on mere physical consideration, throwing away our sense of pride based on such false ideas, one should prostrate before all beings, whether they be dogs, outcasts, cattle or donkeys, seeing all of them as manifestation of the Supreme Being, which is true jnana." Uddhava answered, "This is too difficult for me. I see that what you say is true, but the mind is weak. I may not be able to put this jnana into practice. Knowledge alone is not enough without the wisdom to practice it. Teach me a simpler path." The Blessed Lord replied, "Until the consciousness that all beings are my manifestation has been assimilated by the mind, one should commune with me through external worship and action. By doing this, a devotee gains that knowledge by which he perceives everything as Brahman. Of all methods of spiritual discipline, the best according to me is to practice seeing my presence in everything. Through the functioning of the three instruments of the mind, speech and action. This is the essence of the Bhagavata Dharma, in which all actions are done as a dedication to me, without expectation of their fruits. In this, there is no waste of effort. Unlike rites performed with the desire for their benefits, which would end in total failure if done improperly, in this path, every act serves to help one's spiritual evolution, if not in this birth, then in another. The basis of these actions being spiritual, their effects are imperishable. Even mundane actions like crying or running away, if done as a dedication to me, come to have a spiritual potency. What need is there then to speak of those high spiritual action practice consciously? To reach me, the immortal, with the help of this mortal body, is the wisdom of the wise and the skill of the skillful. To reach me, the immortal, with the help of this mortal body, is the wisdom of the wise and the skill of the skillful. Thus, O Uddhava, do your work after having dedicated the fruits of it to me, regardless of success or failure. For when you have dedicated it to me, it is my duty to see that you get the just result. The best advocate does not care whether his case is right or wrong. His duty is only to place the fact before the judge. It is for the judge to pass the judgment. Therefore, let me be the judge of your actions." Then in answer to Uddhava's questions about devotional methods, the Lord gave him an elaborate account of those practices which are open to all. At the end, he concluded, "These are the many ways in which I may be worshipped, Uddhava, but the safe rule is to offer everything to me. As I have told you, But if you still wish to offer something particular, remember that whatever is offered with love, I will gladly accept. Be it a leaf, a flower, some fruit, or even water, if it is offered with love, I will be immensely pleased. The best puja is that which is done without any desires. For then I myself will decide what is best for the devotee. The best puja is that which is done without any desires. For then I myself will decide what is best for the devotee. At the end of the puja, you should renounce the sense of personal action, offer your very soul or Atman to me, and then the puja will purify you. Uddhava then asked, what should I do if I am in the desert where not even water is available? With what should I worship you then? The Lord smiled and said, as long as the water in your eyes has not dried up. My friend, do not fear. One drop from my devotee's eyes is more precious to me than the costliest diamond. As long as the water in your eyes has not dried up, my friend, do not fear. One drop from my devotee's eyes is more precious to me than the costliest diamond. Uddhava was overwhelmed when he heard this, and his eyes brimmed with tears. For a few minutes he could not utter a word. At last he rallied himself and asked still another question, not for himself but for the sake of posterity. Even these things about which you have spoken may be too difficult for me, Maho Master. I may not be able to go on a pilgrimage. I may not be able to offer daily worship to you. The age of Kali is at hand, and people have short memories and short lives and no time to accomplish anything. Give me then a shortcut that will lead me to you. Krishna smiled tenderly. He replied, until my advent, O Uddhava, an immersion in the Ganga was supposed to eradicate all sins. And now an immersion in the holy story of my life is enough to cleanse the sins of 1,000 lifetimes. The ones who listen to the story of my life, who narrate it or explain it to others, will sanctify themselves as well as their listeners. If even this is difficult, O Uddhava, take a dip in the flowing river of my names. The chanting of my name alone is enough to attain liberation. My names are not difficult to learn like the Vedic mantras, which are reserved for the favored few. They can be enjoyed and repeated by anyone, regardless of birth or sex. Sweeter than honey is my name, giving bliss to those who utter it, as well as those who hear it. It is the ripe, juicy fruit of the Vedas. Like a calf following its mother, I myself will follow the ones who call on my name in order to see that no harm comes to him. Thus listening to the tales of my life and chanting my name, you will definitely be victorious over death itself. After studying this discourse, there is nothing more for a spiritual aspirant to inquire about and understand, just as after taking honey, there is nothing sweeter for one to drink. Again we will read. Even these things are about which you have spoken may be too difficult for me, O Master, said Uddhava. I may not be able to go on a pilgrimage. I may not be able to offer daily worship to you. The age of Kali is at hand. People have short memories, short lives, and no time to accomplish anything. Give me then a shortcut that will lead me to you. Krishna smiled tenderly at him. Until my advent, O Uddhava, an immersion in the Ganga was supposed to eradicate all sins. But now, an immersion in the holy story of my life is enough to cleanse the sin of 1,000 lifetimes. The ones who listen to the story of my life, who narrate it or explain it to others, will sanctify themselves as well as their listeners. If even this is too difficult, O Uddhava, take a dip in the flowing river of my names. That word is very important. No? Take a dip in the flowing river of my names. I must immerse myself. Take a dip in the flowing river of my names. The chanting of my name alone is enough to attain liberation. My names are not difficult to learn like the Vedic mantras, which are reserved for the favored few. They can be enjoyed and repeated by anyone, regardless of birth or sex. Sweeter than honey is my name, giving bliss to those who utter it, as well as those who hear it. It is the ripe, juicy fruit of the Vedas. Like a calf following its mother, I myself will follow. The ones who call on my name, in order to see that no harm comes to them, thus listening to the tales of my life and chanting my names, you will definitely be victorious over death itself. After studying this discourse, there is nothing more for a spiritual aspirant to inquire about and understand, just as after taking honey, there is nothing sweeter for one to drink. Being thus instructed by the Lord, Uddhava stood speechless for a while. Conscious of the great blessing that the Holy One had bestowed on him, with great effort he controlled his mind, which had been overpowered by emotion, his voice choking with surging waves of love and his eyes overflowing with tears, he said, "When you have departed from these mortal coils, O Lord, where will I find you? Where will I seek for you?" The Holy One replied, "Go to my temples, O Uddhava. I will be residing there. And if you are in any doubt as to where my temples are situated, I will tell you, my temples are in the hearts of my devotees. Therefore, go where my devotees congregate. Wherever you hear my name chanted and my stories recited, there will also you can. Therefore, seek me among my devotees, for through them I will ever manifest myself in this world." Uddhava remained silent, speechless, with grief at the thought of the imminent parting. The Lord looked at him with infinite tenderness and asked, "My beloved one, have I convinced you? Have you heard enough? Are your doubts cleared?" With sobs choking his voice, eyes brimming with tears, Uddhava spoke, "O Supreme Preceptor, your very proximity has removed my delusion born of ignorance. Just as a burning fire dispels the darkness, cold or fear of those who sit near, you have lighted the lamp of knowledge in the darkness, dark recess of the mind. You have ignited the unquenchable flame of your divine name in my heart. You have broken asunder my strong bond of attachment to my kinsmen. You have permeated my entire being so that nothing other than you exists for me anymore. What can I offer you, who have given me my all? What gift can I place before you? You are who are the giver of all gifts. Therefore, do I place myself as an offering at your lotus feet. O Lord, I have nothing else to give you." So saying, he prostrated full length before the soul of compassion, and catching hold of his lotus feet, he cried out, "Prostrations to you, O Master Yogi. I have surrendered to your lotus feet. I have no other refuge but you. Bless me with deep and undying devotion to your feet. Wherever I may wander, whatever I may do, let my mind run to you every second, every minute, and feel for you that love which is eternal, indescribable." Uddhava lay on the ground like a fallen log, unable to rise up, unable to do anything but bathe the Lord's feet with his tears. The Holy One laid his hands firmly on the bowed head, blessed him. He then gently helped him to rise up and gave his final instruction. "O Uddhava, I direct you to go to the famous place of pilgrimage in the Himalayas, known as Badrikashram, which is especially sanctified by my presence. There flows the river Alagananda, the very sight of which is purifying. wearing clothes made of bark, subsisting on roots and fruits, free from all desires for worldly enjoyment, live without caring for the extremes of climate, putting up patiently with all the adverse situations that might confront you, ponder deeply in solitude over that which I have taught you, with speech and thought ever absorbed in me, live according to the dictates of Bhagavata Dharma I have taught you, and you will quickly pass through these material realms, attain to my transcendent state. Instructed thus by that Holy One, Uddhava circumambulated his dearest master, placed his head once more at his feet. Though his mind had transcended the three gunas, the thought of leaving his beloved master and going to Badrinath produced such waves of agony in his heart that it expressed itself in torrential tears, which flowed down his cheeks, washed the Lord's holy feet. With his mind stricken at the thought of the imminent separation from his dearest Lord, he found it impossible to move from that place, stood rooted to the spot, gazing at the well-loved face as if he could not bear to tear his away from it. The Lord, understanding his predicament, spoke, "Dearer to me than my sons, dearer to me than my wives are you, O Uddhava, for you are the shining examples of the Jnani Bhakta. You have fettered me to yourself with the bonds of your intense love. Yet the time has now come for our bodies to part. For they are made of the five elements, must return to them. So go, my faithful friend, do as I have instructed you." Seeing Uddhava still reluctant, he continued, "In my previous incarnation as Rama, when I had to part from my beloved brother Bharata, I had given him my footwear, like you. He could not bear to be parted from me. Now I will give them to you, my dear friend, for they have been attached to my feet, the ultimate goal of all devotees. Take them therefore, proceed to Badrikashrama, for I have no further use for them." Reverently, Uddhava accepted the precious gift. With tears streaming from his eyes, he addressed them, "O divine Padukas, do not think too harshly for me, for being the cause by which you have been forced to separate from his lotus feet. Forgive me. Taste once more of the perfume of those tender feet, and then let us depart." So saying, he placed them once more tenderly beneath the Lord's blessed feet, and then holding them with great reverence on his head, he circumambulated the divine presence once more. With eyes blinded by tears, he tore himself away with many a backward glance. Only now did he experience the bitter anguish suffered by the gopis of Vrindavana so many years ago. He had gone there to tell them, you know. When he turned around, for the last time he saw Krishna's eyes following him. And for the first time, he saw a glimmer of fear in those lustrous orbs. He ran back, fell at his feet once more. The Lord said nothing, but gently placed his foot on Uddhava's bent head, thus passed on to him the supreme wisdom. Then tenderly